The Time Machine by H.G. Wells. Narrated by Guy Barnes. The Time Machine by H.G. Wells. Introduction, Vivian Heller. Narrated by Guy Barnes. H.G. Wells wrote The Time Machine in 3 weeks in the summer of 1894. He was 27 years old, in bad health, with shaky finances and a marriage that was in the process of falling apart. The novella was an immediate hit, marking the beginning of his remarkable success in the young genre known as scientific romance that we now call science fiction. What was so new about The Time Machine? Before the 1890s, many literary characters had travelled through time via dreams and trances and visions, but none had tackled time travel as a scientific experiment. The novella begins with a hypothesis delivered to a room of smirking dinner guests. The theory that time is the fourth dimension is subsequently proven by the time traveler's risky adventures in the future. If we have encountered stories that begin with a scientist claiming that he has discovered a way to conquer linear time, who is dismissed as overtired or eccentric or out of his mind, it's because Wells set the pattern with The Time Machine. About 10 years after The Time Machine came out, Einstein presented his special theory of relativity to the world. Although Einstein and Wells didn't actually meet until they were of advanced age, they often crossed paths in the realm of science fiction. Characters would argue for time as the fourth dimension, invoking the theories of Einstein to back them up. And then those same characters would set out in increasingly complicated vehicles that traced back to the handmade contraption, built of nickel, ivory, and rock crystal by the ingenious time traveler. But what does the time traveler discover about civilization when he arrives in 802,701 AD? Instead of finding that humanity has advanced, he finds himself in what one critic called an ironic utopia, inhabited by good-natured elfin human beings who strike the time traveler as childish and weak-minded. The time traveler soon discovers that this paradise is not as sunny as it seems. There is a darker reality underground. Travelling billions of years forward, he finds that the world has devolved into a doomed planet that is moving ever closer to a dying sun. Living in a time of global upheaval and climate change, it is easy for us to relate to the pessimism of Wells's vision. And yet, there is an uplifting message in The Time Machine too. A reminder that utopia should never be our goal, and that our attempts to arrive at perfect societies necessarily depend on cruelty. In the words of the time traveler, "There is no intelligence where there is no change or need of change. Only those animals partake of intelligence that have to meet a huge variety of needs and dangers. A world shielded from labor and toil can only be achieved by brutality exploiting a portion of our population. Struggle and constant negotiation is what makes us human and what keeps us truly alive." Chapter 1. The Inventor. The man who made the time machine, the man I shall call the time traveler, was well known in scientific circles a few years since, and the fact of his disappearance is also well known. He was a mathematician of peculiar subtlety, and one of our most conspicuous investigators in molecular physics. He did not confine himself to abstract science. Several ingenious and one or two profitable patents were his. Very profitable they were, these last, as his handsome house at Richmond testified. To those who were his intimates, however, his scientific investigations were as nothing to his gift of speech. In after-dinner hours, he was ever a vivid and variegated talker, And, at times, his fantastic, often paradoxical conceptions came so thick and close as to form one continuous discourse. At these times, he was as unlike the popular conception of a scientific investigator as a man could be. His cheeks would flush, his eyes grow bright, and the stranger the ideas that sprang and crowded in his brain, the happier and the more animated would be his exposition. Up to the last, there was held at his house a kind of informal gathering, which it was my privilege to attend and where, at one time or another, I have met most of our distinguished literary and scientific men. There was a plain dinner at 7. After that, we would adjourn to a room of easy chairs and little tables, and there, with libations of alcohol and reeking pipes, we would invoke the god. At first, the conversation was mere fragmentary chatter, with some local lacunes of digestive silence. But towards 9 or 9:30, if the god was favourable, some particular topic would triumph by a kind of natural selection, and would become the common interest. So it was, I remember, on the last Thursday but one of all, the Thursday when I first heard of the time machine. I had been jammed in a corner with a gentleman who shall be disguised as Philby. He had been running down Milton. The public neglects poor Philby's little verses shockingly, and as I could think of nothing but the relative status of Philby and the man he criticized, and was much too timid to discuss that, the arrival of that moment of fusion when our several conversations were suddenly merged into a general discussion was a great relief to me. "What's that? It's nonsense," said a well-known medical man speaking across Philby to the psychologist. "He thinks," said the psychologist, "that time's only a kind of space." "It's not thinking," said the time traveller. "It's knowledge." "Foppish affectation," said Philby, still harping upon his wrongs. But I feigned a great interest in this question of space and time. "Kant," began the psychologist. "Confound Kant," said the time traveller. "I tell you I'm right. I've got experimental proof of it. I'm not a metaphysician." He addressed the medical man across the room and so brought the whole company into his own circle. "It's the most promising departure in experimental work that has ever been made. It will simply revolutionize life. Heaven knows what life will be when I've carried the thing through." "As long as it's not the water of immortality, I don't mind," said the distinguished medical man. "What is it?" "Only a paradox," said the psychologist. The time traveller said nothing in reply, but smiled and began tapping his pipe upon the fender curb. This was the invariable presage of a dissertation. "You have to admit that time is a spatial dimension," said the psychologist, emboldened by immunity and addressing the medical man. "And then all sorts of remarkable consequences are found inevitable."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.